we can just take it from there,
Now,
like
many
last
points,
time.
obviously, after speaking to you, I was kind of looking. I did a bit more research in terms of the market piece. It's a massive hobby of mine. Obviously, especially looking at people of the world and what they're doing and what they're saying,
Yes.
high-profile people, what the market
Yeah.
piece is. But also a big one then, something that we see this month is the whole disclosure. How does that work in terms of prophecy? Is it biblical? And I've just come across more and more scripture to back up. Now, it's my opinion, and I always give a disclosure on it. I'm not going to say everything's 100% fact, but when we use scripture and when we give more scripture to back it up, it's very hard to deny some of the stuff that we're probably going to actually talk about today. Now, I will probably ask you a couple of questions on some of the stuff you've just shared. The harvest being a big one. I know it's very hard to squeeze it into 5 minutes, but we can get the fundamentals out there, especially for anyone from my channel that's going to be watching this, just to kind of give them a quick breakdown on the harvest, the main points of the harvest, and according to kind of the resurrection, which I'm going to leave in your hands. So I'll ask you a couple of questions on that. But this whole thing, the big one for me at the moment is the UFO, what we call the UFO. I don't even like using that word, but everyone knows it for that. The disclosure, how it ties into Genesis 3, Genesis 6, Revelation 13, and then we see Paul talking about it in some of the epistles as well. As I say, it's very hard to deny what I believe they're going to be doing. And these high-profile people are starting to tell us what they're going to be doing, which is the scariest part. But people, I've watched a couple of programs. I'll kind of open on this about a serial killer and an investigator who was investigating kind of the whole rabbit trail behind it. And the killer himself says, regardless of how much evidence you bring forward, people still won't believe it. They want to create their own narratives. Some are
That's
going to
right.
get it. Some people will think, yeah, no, they may think it's good and believe us. Some people have called me a heretic because of certain beliefs I may hold. That's between them and God. I can just give the scriptures, and then they have to go and do the research and go into the scriptures themselves. So be encouraged. We're doing something right if they're calling us all sorts.
Especially if the majority is against us, then you're on
Yeah,
the narrow
yeah.
road. So.
It's a huge amount. Well, I'll open up with this, kind of start on the easier of them all, which is probably what's happening at the moment. What would you think of the UFO? What's kind of your main view of what the UFO disclosure is? What do you think will come about from it?
Well, I think, initially, or what we read from the Word of God is that, it will be as in the days of Noah, and we know what happened during those days, So, the fallen angels were on the earth, and people had no question about it. I mean, Enoch was discussing certain things with them. He was interceding for them, and obviously, Jesus said that, in the last days or before his coming, it will be again as in the days of Noah. So there will definitely be sort of a repeat that I can see that will happen. And I think it, the Bible also tells us that there will be great deception that will come to deceive people, and that this will be part of the deception that will come over the world. And the deception is to, this is also my personal opinion, is to deceive people as to where those people went that disappeared, and that would be sort of the main reason for it, and then also to get people to follow the Antichrist, which will probably be part of this disclosure that will come after the church, or those that will be raptured after they are gone. So yeah, that's sort of my view in a nutshell about the reason behind the UFO phenomena.
Yeah, I mean, just obviously to let people know, I done a poll on my channel yesterday, just asking about what type of topics you want to cover. I used the Nephilim as one of them, because not a lot of people would have. It's after getting popular in the last kind of 15 years compared to when I kind of started looking into it. And obviously that's what you're quoting from in terms of days of Noah in Genesis 6, which obviously talks about there was giants in those days, or Nephilim, depending on the word you use, where the sons of God, daughters, daughters of men were beautiful, took themselves wives, and obviously from their offspring is where we get the Nephilim, which is something that I believe. I really do. I believe that's the narrative that's real. Obviously then we have extra biblical texts like Enoch, that kind of goes really deep into it. And people would say, ah, we can't really use Enoch, it's not the canon. But he is mentioned throughout the New
Yeah,
Testament. So there
exactly.
is a principle for us to read it, and there's some really insightful stuff. Now,
Yeah.
when it comes to the actual UFO, the whole phenomenon, it's very hard for us to push this whole UFO thing away because there's so many sightings, all of the stuff that people are recording. Yes, are some of it fake? I'm sure some of them are making them. I mean, we'd have to put hands on heart here, but not all of them. There's too many for it all to be fake.
Yeah.
How I believe it's going to tie in, when we look at scripture, we've seen, obviously, in Luke 21, just before, obviously, Christ coming back, it talks about certain signs, certain things that will happen. And I'll paraphrase here from Luke 21, signs in the sun, the moon, the stars, upon the earth, distress of nations. But the one thing I looked at was the perplexity was the word that was used, which is a strange one, which means the inability to deal with or understand something. So I believe something's coming down. Some people would say, oh, that's the actual coming of Christ. I think most people reading Revelation, people know he's coming and fear and tremble. They know what's coming. So there's something happening here that they can't explain. It's never happened before, obviously, and we're his generation. To actually see it, I call it the powers in the heavens, because after studying what the powers are, it's an actual entity up above. And with time, as Christ gets closer, as he starts to shake, we're going to see it come. And you actually pointed on it there. Deception is the biggest key as believers that we have to look for, because Christ himself, in the Olivet Discourse, he used deception three times. Don't be deceived if they say this. Don't be deceived if they do this. Don't be deceived if they do this. So deception is going to be huge. He started with deception in the garden, and he's going to finish with deception at the end. So I really do believe, obviously, disclosure, most of us know supernatural beings, you could call it, some people would say they're demonic. Fine, it's definitely there. They're not Martians, it's not ET phone home. It's much bigger than ET phone home.
Extra dimensional beings, yeah, they've been here all along.
Yeah,
So,
in and out. I'll phrase it this way. I've been after we spoke the last time, Jaco, and it kind of blew my mind with some of the stuff. I had to kind of put myself aside and focus. Romans 8 for me is really, it's a really solid scripture. You know, when I'm trying to bring this message across to people about not everything is spiritual and not everything is physical. We have both. We've seen a vision. Paul tells us to put on the full armor, even though it's a spiritual battle. Because what we do now in terms of our prayer and our warfare manifests itself in the spiritual. Now, what I kind of question, what happens if the spiritual manifests itself in the physical for us? Which I believe can happen. And just to read this real quick, I'll open on this and kind of get your thoughts on this one. It's in Romans 8. It says, "For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus." That scripture alone is, for me, is packed. There's so much in that. I kind of wrote down a list. There's 10 specific things Paul spoke about there, but the one thing that I concentrated on, and I said it to my brother this morning, nor any other creature. Why would Paul use a word like this? Is it something specific? It's obviously not animals, because he would have just said, there's different words you can use for that. There's something more in the spiritual that's going to affect in the physical. And we see it all over Revelation. I mean, it's all in Revelation. Everything in the spirit is going to come down, whether it be Satan, the angels, all the stuff that's going to happen and be poured out. Like the rats, the seals, the bowls. Yes, that's in the spiritual self. It's in the spiritual realm, but it affects us physically here. And that's what I believe the whole UFO phenomenon or deception is going to be.
Yeah, and I mean, the Bible also says, our battle is not against flesh and blood, but against all the powers and principalities of the air, so that's where the real battle is about. And I think, the fact that we are still sort of protected by the restrainer that's on the earth prevents that from fully, manifesting itself on the earth or in the lives of people. And I think, once the restrainer is removed, it will probably be, much more evident to people that are left behind, and they will see everything, the full disclosure will be upon them.
Yeah, it's, I mean, it's scriptures to tie in. That was one I was going to use. Obviously, we know that powers, principalities, that's where the main battle is.
Yeah.
And again, I tried to use, you know, what we call proof text of the spiritual in the physical. And in Hebrews 13, it says, "Be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unaware," which means they look like us.
Yeah, yeah.
But they're not us.
Yeah, yeah, that's right.
They're other dimensional beings. So scripture is there. People try to push this off. And I believe this is where we see gaps, what I would call gaps in scripture. You know, wondering why would God destroy all the men, women, children, animals of sin. But when we tie in the fact that they come in and they can genetically modify and they've corrupted the very thing that God has created us to be, we then actually fill in the blanks. But it's massively, massively big. That this will be one of the bigger deceptions that they've ever seen. It'll be that big, you won't know, probably until it's too late for a lot of people.
Yeah.
That's the scarier part.
That's right.
I was going to put it up last night, but I just felt it wasn't the right time. I'll probably do it tomorrow. Barack Obama is even talking about, you know, a religion being created if it comes out that there's life outside of the earth.
Yeah.
This is where it's all leading. If they can create anything that separates people from knowing who truly who God is, that's the objective of Satan in the end.
I've
touched on it a few times in some of the videos we've just done, but I do believe this is going to be a deception that people need to be aware.
Yeah, and they'll also come forward with the true religion that the world is supposed to follow. You know, now that everybody is sort of ready for advancing to the next level of their evolution, which is all just, you know, lies and deception. That, and most people, you know, that don't understand what the Word of God says about this will have, you know, they will just believe it to be true. You know, these people that seeded the earth, you know, millennia or, you know, millions of years ago or whatever the case may be, you know, they're now back to see that they, you know, the creation is now advancing to the next stage. That's sort of the narrative I can see being promoted. And I mean, I think it's quite evident when you look at those people who are awaiting, you know, this disclosure, you know, sort of from a secular viewpoint, you know, that's also their expectation, you know. So the New Age is full of it. You know, they are expecting this, you know, 5D level up or whatever they call it. But it's unfortunately not true. So, yeah, if they only knew the truth.
The famous professor, the English one, is it Richard Dawkins?
Dawkins, yeah.
Of the beliefs in Darwinism, evolution. And he did an interview. You've probably seen it yourself. And, you know, when I watch interviews like this, and then he brought in the whole, you know, extraterrestrial and being seeded here, he says, well, maybe that's a possibility that there was a higher entity.
Yeah.
But it's not the God.
Not God,
Anything that they do is to make sure it's not Yahweh. Push away from that and they'll use everything and anything but God.
Yeah.
And it's all over the place. It's everywhere.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's also, you know, when people blaspheme the name of the Lord, you know, they would never use other gods' names. You know, it's always just, you know, the God of the Bible. That's the one that needs to become a cuss word, you know. So that's
that was done purposely. That would have been done purposely.
If people just, you know, sit back and look at this and say, why do they not use, you know, the other deities that people have decided to worship, you know, why don't they use their names when they want to curse? It's always, you know, the God of the Bible that has to be mentioned. But anyway, it's just interesting to think about that.
They won't use Buddha or Allah or Muhammad or any kind of what we would call bigger gods that's on the planet at the moment. They'll always use their Christians. They'll always target them. And it's expected. Jesus told us this would happen. You know, he told us this would happen. We have got deceptions of man. Obviously, mankind from the beginning have been quite deceptive as well. Obviously, for greed and power. All of that's happening in the world. We have, obviously, as talked about there with the UFOs, all this type of things. Satan's going to use his deception. Mankind will use his deception. Deception, I've always wondered this, why it's so big. Christ had to, he mentioned it three times as a severe warning that
Yeah.
there will be all types of deceptions in
Yeah,
order
yeah.
that you don't see God. That's the whole purpose of it,
Yeah,
to push
yeah.
people away from Christ and push
Yeah.
people away from God.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think we touched on that at the start as well. I probably should have said this at the start of the video, and I tell people even on my own channel, watch the whole thing, get the scriptures, go to the scripture and find it yourself. Don't judge it until you
Yeah.
actually go search it, because you know, as
Yeah.
I say, cognitive dissonance is very difficult. It took me years to break some of my own because I had a mind frame of, nah, it has to be this way, I'm comfortable with it this way. But when I
Yeah.
started to open up my horizon, the likes of Genesis 6 and Genesis 3, which we know, obviously we know about and spoke on before, and how it ties into kind of Revelation 13, and we use the mark of the beast. And people say, you know, the hardest part is you'll have people who are pre-trib, post-trib, mid-trib, and they'll say if they're pre-trib, we shouldn't be looking at the mark of the beast, we're not going to be here. And it's just there's so much. All of this is to inform both believers of what's happening, but also people who aren't saved who may watch this down the line because it's a severe time. They've been warned, do not take what's coming. Because I truly believe the mark of the beast precursor is here, which we've spoke about. And they're using this as an example, whether it's fully that, I wouldn't put my hand and stamp on it, I'm not sure. But it will be used in that way. The mark of the beast is a massive topic because of the consequence of taking it. If there was no real consequence, you know, we would say just be careful. But because the consequence when you take it, what comes afterwards, we have to tell people to be very, very careful.
And as you said earlier, you know, the Jesus said in Revelation, you know, don't be deceived, or in Luke as well. I mean, everywhere he says, don't be deceived. And in if you read in Revelation, it says, you know, Satan deceived those who took the mark. You know, so and people who are deceived do not know that they are being deceived about it. You know, so and that's why it is so important for me to inform people of what's currently happening, because you know, if you look at the, and this is where it sort of became clear for me, when you look at the statue's feet that Nebuchadnezzar dreamt about, you know, it's not only the toes that's supposed to be mixed between a mixture between iron and clay, it's the feet as well. So the same process that will happen during the tribulation will happen before the tribulation, if you understand the way in which the feet and the toes represent the time that we currently live in. So that is why, you know, I would be very cautious to submit myself to any substance that they would like to put into my body that has the possibility to do some genetic alterations in your body. You know, it plays right into the hand of what we warned about, you know, so not to be deceived about. So yeah, but yeah, there's many there are many people who don't agree, and I think, you know, our Heavenly Father even has their best interests at heart, you know, from what we've seen, you know, how he's now shown us that the enemy has entered the harvest before the time allocated to do so. And I mean, it's similar to you know, when God told Adam and Eve, you know, if you eat of the fruit, you will die, certainly die. And it's true, you know, you can't say it's not true, but that was not the end of the story. You know, Jesus came to take away the curse and to sort of overrule what God said in the beginning. So we no longer die for eternity if we, you know, if because we are born in sin, or you know, our bodies are still subject to sin, and they are not saved yet. Our spirits are renewed and are, you know, become one with the Holy Spirit when we believe, but our bodies obviously are not are still subject to the initial curse. And in the same way, you know, when Satan was preparing to kill Jesus on the cross, you know, he was really responsible for bringing God's perfect sacrifice for sin to the world. You know, if he didn't do that, then the curse would have remained on humanity. You know, if he didn't bring the death of Jesus on the Christ on the cross about. So it's you know, it's you can see God's plan all through the centuries to you know, to make sure that he wins in the end. And I see the same thing happening now with the, you know, the things that are happening in the world right now, where Satan is overstepping and overplaying his hand. and he's entered God's harvest before the allocated or the appointed time that is assigned to him to take what is given to him freely. So it's just another amazing example for me of God's grace for, you know, towards his creation, you know, all of creation, which is clearly stated in the word. So that makes me very excited. And, you know, when the Bible says he will wipe away all tears and, you know, there will be no more sorrow and no more death, then I was always thinking about it, you know, but how do you take away the pain from people who lost their loved ones, you know, to the enemy? You know, they know they're burning in the fire, but you're not going to be sorrowful about it.
Yeah.
It was always a bit strange to me, but now I understand what the plan is. You know, it seems to be that's where we're heading. So, but yeah, it's quite interesting.
Exactly what I've thought about that many times. Like, what do? You take some of their memories away? Because it's not something that you would forget quite easy, especially in case relatives, mothers, fathers. The plan is bigger. I always tell people this. You know, when we look at certain people in Scripture who got, like, prophetic insight, there was at times God says, don't reveal this part. There's things that haven't been revealed, prophecy, etc. Things come into play, certain things open up at certain times. Obviously, what you were touching on there with what's going on in the world. I'm not sure if anyone knows it. I know I spoke to you on this. They got a Nobel Prize for this technology, CRISPR technology. The girl's name, I'm nearly sure she's American, is Jennifer. Jennifer Doudna. And she got it for the, it's not DNA manipulation, it's kind of more gene editing. It's what they focus on. I watched a video last year on it and it stunned me. Now, I tried to use it, but I couldn't for various reasons. They said it was inappropriate. But what I can do is quote what she said. And it's probably a link I'll send to you as well if you want to add it in the description so people know I'm not misquoting or making this up. She does gene editing. She got a Nobel Prize for it. And then she talks about a dream that she had years previous when she kind of got the breakthrough in the CRISPR technology. And in the dream, she turned around and seen a man come out of the shadow who wanted to know about what she was doing. He was curious about it. And it turned out it was Hitler. Then she goes in to talk about what CRISPR does, how obviously if you work in adults, it doesn't get passed down to the next generation. But they want to focus on the embryo stage, the spirit stage, because if they do it at that stage, it'll pass on to the next generation. And she quoted this when she was talking about it. It says, with all this, so it now gives us power to change the very nature of what makes us human. Now, she probably didn't mean, or subconsciously in the back of her mind, know what she was saying by stating something like this. This for me was eye-opening. I could see Genesis 6 and 3. I could see it all being played out. Obviously, God uses us to get some of his plans done by spreading the gospel, reaching people. Satan's going to use some people as well to get his things done. Corrupt the way he did in the beginning. We have Klaus Schwab, which who you probably know, talking about the fusion of the physical, the digital, and the biological. In the industry that I work in, I see this. I see what they're looking to try to do. IoT, I know you do that as well, yourself. It's scary for people who don't know God, but as a believer, it's exciting to see these things start to pick up and get quicker in terms of intensity. It's so exciting to know that someday soon, this could all get wrapped up very, very quickly because we don't know if it could happen very fast or whether it could be prolonged. But I believe personally, it's going to happen very quickly. I believe we're at the feet stage. We're coming very, very close to the toll of Daniel's dream.
Yeah, no, I agree completely. I think also the technology that they reveal to us through the media, you know, all the things that are sort of openly shared is ancient. You know, the things they portray as new technology is very old already. You know, they've got things that are far more advanced than what we are shown. Especially, you know, the things that they put into people's bodies at this point, you know, I think, you know, some of this technology has also been provided by, you know, the principalities and the powers in the air to people who follow after the enemy. So I think much of that is far more advanced than what people think. You know, they would think that if you put a something that's the size of a rice, what particle that you put into your hand, that's sort of new technology, but it's not new technology. It's very old. there are much smaller devices, nanotech
Nanotech.
that can do much more than a rice seed in your implanted in your hand. So I think that's also part of the deception, and I think even Elon Musk's brain implants that he's currently doing, that's it's all technology. I don't think that would be anywhere near to what our enemy is planning for people, and that's part of the deception as well. You take a something that they give you through a needle, and you think it's just it's a normal antidote to a sickness that you have, and it's not, so it's there's technology in there that can basically link your body to an AI system, which is I think what they plan to do. And I mean, this technology has been explained by people as early as 1995. I've seen video clips where they've disclosed that, and they've already told the public how that would work at that point. So it tells you, there's technology that most people are not aware of, and which is used or given to people through deception. That's sort of what I see happening.
Yeah, I mean, I know you touched on it there. There's certain things we can say and certain things we can't say.
Yeah.
But they have technology. I know they have technology now. So when they show us something, let's just say, oh, well, this is what we have now, that was probably from 20 years ago. What they're doing in the other labs are way more advanced. They're way past that stage. Militarily speaking, they're always 20 years ahead of what we're actually seeing today. It's with obviously nanotechnology being one. People say, oh, well, how can you get something in your arm? You need, electricity for it to work. But they actually have technology within the nanodot where the bloodstream actually generates the power, the same way with a windmill as it moves, or a turbine will generate power to keep it on. Your heart will do that. Forget it's like an electronic machine anyway, sending electric shocks around. So it's very easy to do it. They just don't. It's like a game of poker. He's not going to show you his hand. He keeps his hand close to his chest and shows you small bits at a time. It's the way the enemy has worked from the beginning. When
That's
Eve,
right.
he done it, he didn't say exactly what was going to happen, but he deceived her enough to where she was curious. She wasn't afraid of him, so it wasn't in a frightening manner where she was, drawn back. What is this? She was quite comfortable in how she was approached, and she was deceived quite easily and went along. It's going to happen like that as things start to progress. This is why we have to be alert, and I think this is why Jesus and Paul and the other apostles tell us to be, sober-minded, be alert of what's going on. Yes, we live our life. We have to live each day and do the things we need to do, but be alert of what's going on around us so we're not taken by surprise.
That's quite interesting. Yeah, I think I'll edit that little bit out as well as this piece,
Yeah,
but
you can do
yeah, so
half
it's
of it. You
okay.
can take the small bit down. I know what it's like with obviously everything that we say, so I'm always very, very careful. Maybe we can just say, oh, how you would get something in, like an IV, with various antibiotics, etc. So there's ways around it, but this is the times we live in, isn't it?
Yeah,
It's
for
funny
sure,
that we actually
definitely.
live in. I know obviously we covered obviously the UFOs. So we're now looking as we talk. I'm actually getting a full picture and see how it actually all measures, how they can use obviously what's coming or what they're disclosing, how it can tie into the mark of the beast, how they can use that deception to say if when the rapture happens, the disappearance, because they didn't want to be part of society, da 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 da. They can use it all. What I would ask you, if you can, I know it's going to be tough for you because you put a lot of work into it and there's a lot of detail. And anyone that's on my channel, I've told you, there's a link in the video. I'm going to actually put it up on one of my playlists to go deep into what the harvest is, the three parts of the harvest, how it works, in terms of what I'll just say is the rapture. If you could just kind of touch on that there, just to give a brief outline of exactly what it is.
So I think I have to sort of start with where this became an issue for me, or where I my interest in this was triggered. I was studying the word, and I saw, if you understood what was written in a chronological manner, then certain things didn't really seem to make sense, and there were some contradictions that I also saw when I tried to understand what was said. And if you read Revelation 20 verse 4 and 5, then it says, this is the first resurrection. So I thought, well, Jesus was resurrected 2,000 years ago, so how can the resurrection that is spoken of in Revelation 20 be the first resurrection? So, and then I started, digging through scripture and seeing, what understanding is there to obtain that can explain this as being the first resurrection. And then if you just search for resurrection, you go through all the passages in the Bible that talks about it, and then there's one in 1 Corinthians 15 where Paul then says, Jesus is the first fruits of the resurrection, and then after him, every man in his order, all those that have died in Christ, but every man in his order or at his coming, that's when the next will take part. So then you understand, okay, the first resurrection is something that is explaining to us a grouping of people, but it's there's different stages because there's an order in which they would be resurrected. And since Jesus is said to be the first fruits, then okay, it must be somehow tied to the harvest, and then if you look at Leviticus 23, where the harvest is described, or the process of the harvest is described, you then realize that you've got first fruits, you've got the owner's portion, and you've got the gleanings of the harvest that would need to be brought in before the entire harvest is done. So that would then mean that, if Revelation 20 talks about this is the first resurrection, it basically says this is the first harvest. So when those people are resurrected that will be beheaded for the testimony of Jesus and the word of God, those represent the final portion of the harvest. So we know that, and if you then study the gleanings to see, okay, what laws and what rules apply to the gleanings, something that I asked as well when I was studying this is, from what we read in Leviticus 23, the gleanings are given away to the poor and the stranger, so they no longer belong to the owner of the field. So my question was then, how can these people be raised with Christ, or rule with Christ and be his property if they're given away to the poor and the stranger? So how do you reconcile those two concepts? And then, as I was searching and I was asking the Lord, how can you redeem people that are given away to somebody else a second time, or can you buy them back? And then he gave me Leviticus 27, verse 28 and 29, where it says, those who are devoted to God, especially of men, they cannot be redeemed or sold. Those are two things that can't happen to them. And when it comes to men, if they are devoted to God, then and they cannot be redeemed, they have to be put to death. And then it makes perfect sense when you combine what is said in Leviticus 27 with what you read in Revelation concerning the tribulation saints who have to lay down their lives. That means also, if you look at that specific rule that applies to the harvest or the gleanings of the harvest, that if you make it through the tribulation as a believer, who has not been put to death, then you're no longer holy to God. So it means that you will probably have the mark of the beast at the end of it. There's another passage that confirms this if you tie it in with what happens to Israel. So Israel's, or Paul tells us that Israel would be blinded in part until the fullness of the Gentiles come in. And so the fullness of the Gentiles would also be associated with the barley harvest or the faith harvest. And their blindness will only be removed as soon as the full harvest is brought in. If you really look at what the Bible tells us about them, and then Israel also is said to be a nation or a children without faith. So there's a clear delineation between the faith harvest and the wheat harvest that would separate. There are attributes that belong to the faith harvest and or the barley harvest, from those people who put their faith in Jesus for salvation. And Israel, they will have to be shown, like Thomas, who had to put his finger into the marks of the nail marks in the hands of Jesus when he showed himself to the disciples. And that would be the only way through which they can believe that Jesus is their Messiah. And there are several passages, I think, in Zechariah, where they say they will mourn as for someone who lost their only child when they look upon him, whom they whom they crucified. So, you know, through sight, Israel will be saved, but the faith harvest or the barley harvest obviously are saved through faith. And I think our Heavenly Father also has an order in which certain things happen. You know, so the barley harvest, of which Jesus is the first fruits, with the 24 elders that were resurrected with him, and who are now seated in the, you know, the most holy place of the temple. They would seem to be the most important portion of any harvest that would be brought into, you know, eternity or into a glorified state. Then after that, it would be those who died in Christ and those who are worthy to escape at the time of the rapture, which will form the, you know, the second part of the temple, or the which represents the owner's portion of the barley harvest, and those who would lay down their lives for faith during the tribulation, who would then be resurrected at Jesus' second coming, and who would also ascend with the two witnesses once they are resurrected. And I don't know if you've saw, I did a video a long time ago about how the two witnesses mirror exactly what Jesus did while he was on the earth, you know, so their ministries have a lot of similarities. I think there are at least 10 points in which you can draw similarities between what Jesus did on earth and what the two witnesses will do. You know, so for those who say there's a pre-tribulation or a wonder, you know, which one is right, both are right, you know, so there's a pre-tribulation rapture, and there's a there's also one that happens at the end. It's not like, you know, people will be alive during the one that happens at the end. They will be resurrected with the two witnesses and then also caught up into heaven when Jesus comes back. Because I think when he comes back with his bride, which is a complete faith harvest that will consist of all three parts that would be glorified at that point. And that would be his bride that he would bring back. So, but yeah, I don't know if that answers your question. It's in a nutshell.
As I say, for anybody watching, it's very hard to put this into 5-7 minutes. When you're talking, I have a good understanding, because I did watch. You need to watch the build up, just to get, because there's so much detail. But now I obviously have a better understanding, because you use obviously the harvest being three parts, if I can say it that way. You have the three parts of the temple, and then you have the barley and the wine. There's just so much to it. But if people could just watch it, get the understanding, this actually all makes a lot more sense. It really does to me. So when I'm listening now, to me, it makes a lot more sense. I can see where you're actually, what the point of view and where you're actually coming from. It makes much more sense. It answers some questions that I've had for a long time. It answers questions that my mum had, which I told you, though, she has been saved nearly 40 years, and she never seen the harvest that way. Now she's actually studied it, and she reads the Bible consistently every day. She's old school, but it just opened her eyes. But I would say, just drop it in that link as well yourself. Give people the option to go through the 5 videos and the news when you put up. This all makes sense.
Yeah.
You can actually see God's, like, his overview, and his main plan will be to take back. It's so good. It really brings hope. That's what it's all about. It really brings a hope. That regardless what the enemy does, what he uses for bad, God always turns it into something good.
Yeah, always. That's right.
But yeah, now I know it's hard, Jaco, to try to put that into 5 minutes.
It's very difficult. Just keep the essence of it, you know. But yeah, there's a lot of detail that you have to consider. I mean, even, you know, if you look at things like the millennial reign of Christ and what happens there, there's not so much given to us in the Bible, but they're sufficient for us to understand certain things. But even there, you know, if you read the Bible just in a chronological way and try to understand it as it was written chronologically, then you encounter some contradictions with certain passages in the Bible that would seem to, you know, be strange. Things like, you know, many people believe that the new earth and the new heaven will only come after the millennial reign of Christ, which then leads to some contradiction with Isaiah 24, I think, 24, where it says that, you know, the earth will be judged, and it will, you know, reel to and fro like a drunken man, and it will fall and it will not rise again, you know, so, and then you have to ask, when would this happen? And this is when God pours out his wrath over the earth. And that's confirmed for us in Isaiah 13 verse 13, where it says, you know, when the judgment comes, that's when the earth will be destroyed. It doesn't come at the end of the millennium, because in during the millennium, sin will be judged when it's committed. If you really read what's written in the Bible, you know, the sinner will be accursed. It's not, they don't have to wait until the end of the millennium to be going through another judgment. Doesn't work like that, because you know God is on the earth with men at that point, and their sin will be judged as it happens, and they will also receive the reward for that, I suppose. But then, you know, you have to ask, during the tribulation or the end of, or the second half of the tribulation, God has to protect people, or he has to save flesh through that tribulation to make it through. So where do they live after that, during the millennium? And if you read about the conditions on the earth during the millennium, you can see that people will, you know, a child that's 100 years old would be considered, you know, a person who's 100 years old would be considered a child. And we certainly don't have that kind of conditions on the earth currently. So it points to an improvement of the current living conditions, at least. And it would also mean that there would be some restoration that occurs. But then if you consider what is written in Isaiah 24, where it talks about the earth being judged, it says it will fall and it will not rise again. So if it falls and you believe that God will restore the earth for the millennium, then, you know, you have to say, I disregard what's written in Isaiah 24, where it speaks about the earth's judgment. Or I need to adjust my view to understand it in a way that would not make that a contradiction. So it means that, you know, the only way for people to get from the tribulation onto the new, or, you know, into the millennium and have a habitable place to live, would be for God to create the new earth and the new heavens at the start of the millennium, which is, you know, it makes sense, because it's a wonderful place to live in and it will last forever. So why do you only have to create it at the end of the millennium? So yeah, it's just things like that which becomes clear if it's important to you to get to an understanding that, in which your understanding aligns with everything that was written, and you don't allow contradictions to creep in. So, but yeah, that's sort of my approach that I've taken since I think about 2012, when I discovered that, you know, if you study the word in a chronological fashion, you will encounter some contradictions that, you know, the majority of people accept as, you know, sort of just the given. And they taught that as well, you know. So because the new heavens and the new earth is written at the end of the Bible, it has to sort of happen at the end of millennium as well, you know. So that's sort of the approach that can trip people up, you know. So or that's what I've seen anyway.
It's tripped me up a couple of times.
Fit
it in. Honestly, yeah. And that's why sometimes you need to clean your mind of some of the stuff that you know. And just go anew. It was like myself here, redecorating the room. I had to take everything out, clean it all down, and then paint to actually see the difference. Sometimes we have to do it. I've tripped myself up a couple of times and different kind of eschatological views, just small things, just didn't fit. But then when I changed a slight view and then the scriptures to back it up, because if we try to use one verse and one verse alone, it's very difficult to build a foundation on it. But when you go back and then when you use other scriptures, so rather than contradict it, build on it, that's when we start to get the bigger picture. Because sometimes we can look at it when John was writing Revelation. At times he was emphasizing some of the important stuff to get it out, because you can imagine him trying to get it all down and trying to get the information out.
Yeah.
Didn't mean it was all going to happen as A, B, C, D that way. Sometimes he went A, B, C, but let me tell you about W, and then went back to E. To give it so we do have an open view, an unified view of how scripture is actually being kind of interpreted to us.
And a good example of that would be you know, when Matthew writes about Jesus's resurrection as part of the crucifixion narrative, you know. So Jesus was hanging on the cross and he then said, you know, and there was a big earthquake and the graves open. And many of those who slept arose with Jesus after his resurrection. And then he goes back to the crucifixion story. So many people confuse that with, you know, when the earthquake happened and, you know, when People were resurrected from their graves. It didn't happen when
Yeah.
Jesus was died. It happened when he was risen from the grave, which if you don't pay close attention, it could slip you by.
You
So
missed it.
that's
Yeah, no, that's
a
it. That's a great example.
yeah.
Where
Yeah,
you can, because they're trying to emphasize a certain point, they just
yeah.
throw it in to make sure to get it across and then go back to
Yeah.
originally what they were writing. And
Yeah.
that's normal. We do it in movies, we do it in books, we do it in all types of things to
Yeah.
emphasize a certain point and then bring it back to the original narration. It happens.
Yeah.
What I tell
Exactly.
people all the time, and I mean, you'll probably see it yourself, you can never take someone on their word, as in what we're trying to do and what we're trying to tell them. Scripture is clear, but you need to
Yeah.
put the time in and be like the Bereans, where you study. I don't
Yeah.
take a preacher on his word. Yes, I give him the benefit of doubt that he's not trying to deceive me, but I'll go to the word myself and make sure what they're saying, it kind of lines up to scripture. And in the
Yeah.
times we're in, more than ever, everything we say and do, go find it, search the scripture. Don't judge it before you look into it, because I did it before. I judge it because it didn't fit my narrative or my kind of
Yeah.
mindset of how things had worked. I had to strip it away and say, right, what I'll do is I'll strip it all, I'll start new on this, and then go from there. And I start to realize that the story from Genesis to Revelation opens up, and you can actually see the enemy and you can see God in terms of their plan and what they're trying to do. But overall, God's plan will always prevail.
And it's also interesting to see how God reveals this understanding over time. 20 years or so ago, we would have had no idea of what we know today. So it's really amazing how his word is always fresh. Every day,
Yeah.
there's something new that you discover from his word that is just amazing. And I think,
Yeah.
even in the ages to come, it will continue to do that. We will see things that we've never seen before, just showing us more of his grace and mercy towards his people that he created.
Yeah. I mean, as I say, with the harvest, was an eye-opener for me. Yes, I know about the harvest, I've read it. But when you see it from a different point of view, when you put things aside, it really opens up and you can see God's plan. He's full of hope, he's full of love, he's full of mercy. He doesn't want people to suffer. He has thoughts of he has thoughts of good plans for you, not to be in danger, plans to put you, as we see in Jeremiah. Everything that we see happening, yes, it looks dark on the outside. I mean, because we do, well, that's what we see at the moment. It's all dark, there's all the bad stuff, which is all obviously spoke about. But behind it all, and in the midst of it all, God has an overall plan, which is to bring he wants to bring everybody to him, into a relationship with him. That's the main plan, is to kind of justify people through what Christ done and bring them under his wing. That's generally the plan that God has, that nobody suffers, that everyone comes to repentance and comes to him. The hardest part is for people to take the blindfold off and see God for who he truly is.
Yeah, and I think, as I said in that previous video I uploaded, I think, even those who have been deceived into following the enemy, if they really knew who the enemy was and who God was and what he intended for every person that he created, they wouldn't give
Yeah.
him a second of of their time.
I'd
So
say
I think,
no.
even for those, I think there might be mercy and grace, in store at some point. It doesn't mean that the sentence that will be executed on our enemy Satan will occur immediately, so it might only occur at the end of the millennium when sort of all his actions are done. So it might mean that some of those people might have to endure a very long time in a place they don't want to be, or that was not really intended for them. But I think, our Heavenly Father has a rescue plan even for, those by using the enemy's greediness and his,
Yeah.
overplaying his hands and his hatred for people to get that or get that portion back which was stolen. So and that's just
Yeah.
amazing. And
Yeah.
I
It's
was
such
thinking
times
the
we
other
live in.
yeah I was thinking the other day, I can't remember how this came to me, so it's really something that the Lord has dropped into my spirit to share with others. I'm thinking back of where the initial idea came to me, and I just can't remember. It's really the way the Holy Spirit works, so to give you the insight into the word and to apply it to things that are happening around us today is it's not something we can always do out of our own power or intelligence or insight. It's really something that the Holy Spirit drops into your spirit, and then you realize something sort of out of the blue, and when you start studying it, it just he fills in all the gaps and he shows you exactly where this is heading, and that's so exciting to me. I mean, I just enjoy it, and it's not like I sit for hours and hours and sift through scripture. It's not like that at all. It's like you just have to trust and believe, and then you will receive. That's how it works for me, which is amazing. But yeah, once you once he gives you some of these nuggets, then I just go into the scripture and I start looking at what's available and what more is there to find. And then he drops a verse in my mind, and then I go there and I say, oh yeah, that's amazing. Look at that. Or you're looking for maybe a word search that you do on something specific, like let me think about so first fruits, for instance. And then you go through all the verses where first fruits are mentioned, and you see, oh, look at this, what it said here, and it takes you on a completely different
Kind of
route
journey.
into a more discovery, so that's just amazing. So but anyway,
That
just
actually
thought I'd
happened for
mention
me with it happened for me with the marketplace stuff, the genetics. I've kind of always looked at that over the last while. As I said before, the UFOs, looking up at the stars was never something I did, never something I really kind of focused on. But over a couple of year period, I could just start to see scripture after scripture. And then I decided, you know what, let me, I'll have a look. Let's see if I can find that in here. I looked at what the powers of the heavens were, because when Paul mentioned it was like a specific entity. And it was mentioned a few times. Obviously, it was mentioned in Luke. It's mentioned in Ephesians, talking about no principality nor powers. So it's actually there. And I opened it up. And then I seen the whole thing about creatures. I've seen a few in Job talking about strange, I won't get into it now, creatures, etc. And how it all ties in, and that's why I went down a rabbit hole, and I came out the other end, and now I can see how they can use this plan. It's scriptural, and that's why I love the scripture in Hebrews, where it talks about, about entertaining angels unaware. That shows us that the spiritual came into the physical, just like as we pray and we worship, that goes manifest itself in the spiritual realm and does its job in the spiritual side. As the veil has been opened up towards, obviously, when I get closer to Christ's return, as we're getting there, things of the supernatural will start to manifest itself physically. And this is why people are caught unaware, thinking, hold on, we've never seen anything like this. And perplexity kicks in. And that's what happened to me. And this is why I would encourage people. I always wrap it up that way. Things are happening that we cannot control, but we can warn about. So the likes of have the deception, and we have the disclosure. We said it today, deception. Christ mentioned three times, don't be deceived, don't be deceived, don't be deceived. It's a big thing. Then we obviously see with the mark of the beast, as we would call it, genetic manipulation. They're openly telling us that's something they want to do. And then that kind of links into transhumanism, where they want to live longer, sickness free, etc. And they'll give up their physical attributes to attain it. And we see it, I think you mentioned it before, who was it, am I right in saying it was Esau gave up the birthright for a bowl of soup? Am I right in saying that? People will do that towards the end. They'll be deceived into it to give up that just for a short-term kind of better life.
For a bowl of soup. I mean, that's so worthless if you really look at what your
Yeah,
birthright
what the
in
birthright
Christ
was,
is,
yeah.
So yeah, it's
Yeah.
amazing. But now that you I don't know if you've seen, there's a new series out on Netflix called Sweet Tooth. I don't know if you've seen the trailer for that. It's about hybrids that basically come about after the tribulation,
After the flood.
these mixture between animals and people. I had a look at the first two episodes or so, and it reminded me of Ken Peter's Dream of the Tribulation. I don't know if you've seen that one. I've shared it quite a few times, or some of his things that he shared. But in 1980, he had a dream about
I know the
the
one, Ken Peters.
tribulation. And yeah, that's the one. And he said that at some point people were abandoning their babies, and he didn't know why. So and when you look at this series, you start understanding why he saw that. So people will be giving birth to these hybrid children that will have
Ken Peters.
strange Yeah, so I mean, if you look at the series, you can see they already know what's coming. And I mean, where would this have come from? You know, exactly the things that are going on in the world right now. So, you know, with the modifications and things that are happening. So,
By the way,
and
actually,
it's
what's it called? Sweet Tooth.
Sweet Tooth. Yeah. Have a look.
I'll have a look at it.
It's sort of biblical. You know, the enemy explaining exactly what's going to come, and you know, he's hiding it in a little story about this deer kid, you know, this kid who's got some deer genetics in him, and there are, you know, others with pig genetics in it, and I don't know,
They have chimeras
it's
and all
bomber.
this.
Yeah, exactly. So, but yeah,
That's what they do. They give us little hints of what they're looking to do. I always, as I say, I know obviously we don't with this going too long. I'll wrap it up like this for myself. As I say, things are going to happen that we can't control. Yes, we watch. Yes, we warn. We obviously most we're longing for Christ to come back, His return. That's obviously our blessed hope. Don't be deceived at the big message. Don't be deceived because I can bring this message as in what they're doing. It comes across as dark, but by the time they bring it, it's going to look good. If the temptation's going to look sweet, it's going to look kind of rosy, and people will fall for deception. Be aware of what the enemy's trying to do, which is total separation between you and God. Time is running out. They are exciting times we're living in, as watchmen, as watchwomen, people out there as well. We can only give the signs, we can only look out at what we see happening and try to kind of intellectualize it to you guys to be ready for anything that could happen. But the main principle we're always looking for is Christ to come back.
Yeah, and I have to agree with what you said, James. And I would have to add that, you know, make the Word of God your primary focus in your life at this point, you know. So that has to be your source of truth. You have to understand it and ask the Holy Spirit to reveal to you what you read. Don't just take people's message for, you know, for granted or for the truth. You have to compare everything that is said with the Word of God and see if it is true. And if it contradicts what the word says at some point, then, you know, take the meat out of it and spit out the bones. Don't throw everything away, because I've seen the Lord use many people, you know, who may not always give the absolute truth to people, but there are certain truths that you can extract from what they're saying. But you have to identify what is false and just, you know, discard that. So, but yeah. The time
We're
is
human
short,
after
and
all.
yeah, exactly. And we don't all have the truth, you know, so or the exact truth. We can just try our best to get as close as we can, and we can ask the Holy Spirit to help us with that. But yeah, to do it on our own, it's not going to happen. And you know, it's really important that we know what is true in these days. You know, we deception is really, you know, there's rife in this world. So it's not like we're going to you know, the enemy's not going to put up billboards and tell us what he's going to do to us. He's going to get people to be deceived into believing lies, you know, and to suffer the consequences as a result.
100%. 100%.